created for the Rio Grande Oil Company.
Afternoon, the police calling all cars. Attention all cars. Broadcast 104. Go to Columbia and Orange Grove Avenues at once. Be on the lookout for a car with two men. Believed to be bandits who just robbed the Pasadena National Bank. These men are armed and desperate. That's all.
Thousands of boys and girls have joined the Rio Grande Junior Police Department. They are equipped with junior police badges, Sam Brown belts, police pistols, siren whistles, handcuffs. Thousands of girls are wearing the sergeant's ring and the identification bracelet. All these and many other articles comprising the junior detective outfit are furnished absolutely free of charge by the Rio Grande Oil Company. We invite every boy and girl to join the junior police and to enjoy the many free gifts. Just go to any independent dealer selling Rio Grande cracked gasoline, and he'll give you a free copy of the latest issue of the Calling All Cars News, which tells you how to get the complete junior detective outfit absolutely free. And now a word of warning to the parents of these boys and girls. You are using Rio Grande cracked gasoline in your car because you believe that the gasoline used, because you believe that the gasoline used by more police cars, fire engines, police motorcycles, ambulances, and emergency equipment than any other brand must be the fastest gasoline you can buy. That's true. But frankly, the lively power of Rio Grande cracked gasoline is a constant temptation to drive faster than you should. We warn you against yielding to that temptation. Police have declared a war on speeders as relentless as their war on crime. Save that extra speed for an emergency when you've got to get out of the way quick to avoid collision. Police cars use Rio Grande cracked gasoline because they have proved by test in a score of cities that during the long hours of slow cruising over city streets, 24 hours a day, Rio Grande cracked is the most economical gasoline they can buy. But when the emergency comes, when the police car must reach the top speed instantly, then you see why police specify Rio Grande cracked. It has the most tremendous reserve power of any gasoline. An extra refining process gives cracked gasoline that extra speed to meet emergency. And yet these extra advantages cost you no more. You can get Rio Grande cracked the same price you pay for ordinary gasoline and enjoy police car performance at no extra cost. It is our pleasure now to present Chief James E. Davis of the Los Angeles Police Department.
Good evening, friends. I have often emphasized on these programs the necessity for close cooperation between various law enforcement bodies. Tonight, we have asked a man whose cooperation I value highly to be our guest. It is from the files of his police department that the case you're about to hear was dramatized. Friends, it is my great pleasure to present Chief of Detectives Stanley Decker of the Pasadena Police Department.
Thank you, Chief Davis. I feel indeed honored to be a guest on Calling All Cars and to have the opportunity to bring to the radio audience of the West a story from our files. A case that you will hear shortly is a vivid proof of the willingness with which your police officer will risk his very life that your property may be preserved and the peace of your community maintain. When you consider his modest income, for which your policeman works, and you consider how little this golden opportunity his occupation holds for him, you may well be amazed at the dangers he is willing and eager to meet on your behalf. If you will pardon my understandable enthusiasm, your policeman is a great fellow, deserving of your highest respect, admiration, and support.
March 20th, 1924. Into the Ford agency and the quiet little town of Alhambra walks a young man. Looks at several cars, beckons to the salesman on duty.
Isn't there something in the way of transportation?
Yeah, but maybe you might have a good news job here that wasn't priced too high. Only in town for a couple of months. I don't want to spend a lot of dough on a car. Just want something to get around in. And you got something pretty reasonable?
Let me see now. I tell you what. I think I've got just the car for you. The 23 Ford. In the very best of condition. New rubber, fine, paint job. Runs like $1 million.
How much?
I'll tell you what I'll do for you. I'll make it $250, and that's a buy.
Yeah, it probably is, but not for me. I don't want to spend over $100. And you got a car that'll get me around with that price?
$100? Well, of course, that's not very much money, but well, perhaps I can find something.
How about that old coupe over there? Looks as though it ought to be around $100.
That automobile for $100? Why, that's a good car. You just spent a lot of money fixing it up. I could let you have it for $175,
maybe. No, $100 flat, and that's my price. But if anything to fit my purse, I guess I'll have to look around somewhere else.
Wait a minute. Tell you what I'll do. I'll speak to the boss and see what he says. Maybe I can get you a better price on it.
I'm going to too much trouble.
Oh, not at all. No trouble. If you'd like to look the car over, I'll be back in a minute.
Okay. I'll take a look at the bus. Maybe I won't want it after I look it over.
Well, you'd be making a mistake. It's a mighty clean job.
It's not to fail. It's not to walk out in the taxi. It's clear to take the car away. The door works anyway. Wonder if it runs. If it's starter, at least I won't have to crank it. It runs. Not good, but good enough to get as far as I'm going.
Well, I've got good news for you. The boss says it's okay at $100, and I say that's a real buy.
You would. Well, I guess it'll get me around all that.
If you'll step over to the office here, we can make out the papers.
Okay.
Right in here.
Thanks.
You want to pay cash?
Yeah, I'll give you a check for it.
A check? You haven't got the cash, have you?
Of course not. You don't think I'm walking around with $100 in my pocket, do you? As a matter of fact, I only got in town a little while ago. I haven't even established credit here.
You got a check on a local bank?
Better than that. Got a cashier's check on a mutual bank in Chicago. It certainly ought to be good enough.
Would you mind letting it here? Just a formality, of course. The boss is kind of particular about our taking checks.
It is. Good as gold. That's the biggest bank in Chicago's failed since I left there 5 days ago.
Mm-hmm. Made out for $150.
Well, I don't happen to have one for $100 even. And I figured I could get 50 in cash. Isn't that all right?
Well, yeah, I guess so. Check seems to be all okay. Now, if you just sign this receipt here, I'll endorse the pink slip over and you're all set.
Fine. On this line?
That's right.
There you are. John Henry complete.
Edward Fells, Chicago, Illinois. And here's the pink slip on the Ford. Thanks a lot, Mr. Fells. I'm sure you'll get a lot of satisfaction out of the car.
I hope so. And thanks for getting me such a good price. I won't forget it.
Check for $150 on the mutual bank of Chicago.
That's right, Sergeant. This morning, come back, Mark. Not easy to this bank. So I owe you to find this man and get my money back.
Well, I doubt if he'll have much of it left. We'll try to pick him up for you. Now, if you'll give me the description of the car, I'll start the boys looking for it.
It's a 1921 Ford coupe.
What color?
Black. The license number is 133745.
133745. All right, Mr. Jones. We'll get after it right away and let you know as soon as we get this place up.
I'm telling you, Adam, if things don't get better pretty soon, I'm going to close up the store. I don't know what's the matter with people. Maybe they ain't thinking anymore.
Maybe you need some advertising, George. That fellow makes gum. He says, tell them quick and tell them often. And he says, plenty of gum.
Well, There's a lot of difference between something you chew and a can of paint. No, sir, it ain't advertising I need. It's the customer.
Well, ain't much use in talking about it. That won't sell no paint. How about a little game of runner?
You're on. That is, if I can remember where I put the cards last time we played. I tend to come around this Sunday. No. Thank you.
I tell you, George, you're getting absent-minded like. I was reading just the other day about a scientist fella who says that the American people are losing their natural concentration. Or something like that. He says we all ought to read more. Stimulate the mind.
Here we are. I swear, put them on the shelf. Set up stable, Adam, while I get stairs.
Don't give me the one you did last time. Darn thing like they're falling apart with me sitting in it. Look, George, you got a customer, maybe.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Doolittle.
You
want some paint?
Yeah, quite a lot of paint. I got a couple of barns to cover.
What do you have in mind? Outside paint?
Yeah, a couple of gallons of that and some good inside enamel, too. Got a lot of brickwork to do.
Well, I've got some mighty fine house paint here that ought to do the trick. What color do you think you'd be wanting?
Oh, white, I guess. Yeah, plain white will be fine.
Well, here's the best paint I ever seen for a rough work.
How much is it?
I see a mark here on the bottom of the can. Adam, you remember the price on this stuff?
Why don't you look on that little list you made out? It's hanging right there in front of your nose.
All right, yes, let's see. White, rough finish, cold water painting. $3 a gallon.
$3 a gallon, huh? Well, I'll need about 3 gallons of that and a couple of quarts of white enamel.
Yes, sir. This here enamel is about the best for the money. 6 cents quart.
Okay. I guess that's about all. You got a pen?
Pen?
Yeah, you know, something you write in ink with.
Well, now, I don't know exactly whether I have one around here, neither. Adam, you got that fountain pen of yours with you?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. Here you are, mister.
Good. I've got a cashier's check here for $50. I'll be all right, won't it?
$50? Ooh.
What's the matter? Have you got that much money?
Well, I got it right here on hand, but I guess I can get it next door.
Well, I hope so. If you got any cash on me, I got to get this paint now so I can get started on those bonds right away. If you haven't got it, I can go to another paint store.
Oh, no. I'll get it all right, I think.
George, can I see you a moment?
Huh? Oh, sure. Pardon me a minute, Mr.
Yeah, go right ahead.
George, I've got enough in my wallet to cash that check if you want.
You got... Where'd you get all that money?
It's here, the payment on the house. The bank's due till tomorrow, and you can get that check cashed to the bank before then. Here, you want it?
I'll say I do. This is the first $10 sale I've made so long that I just can't afford to lose it.
All right, here, take it.
Thanks a lot, Adam. I appreciate it. There you are, mister. $40 even. The paint come to just 10.
Okay, here's your check. Well, good afternoon, gentlemen.
And good afternoon.
Afternoon. Well, George, as someone once said, peace with the devil.
The money was for the monthly payment on the house of my friend here, so you see if I can get up to something about.
Well, if you'll just take it easy now, maybe I can get some sense out of this thing. Now, you say the fellow gave you this check for $10 of the paint, eh?
That's right, and it ain't any good.
And it's the only money I got, and if I don't make that payment, the old lady will kill me.
All right, just try to keep yourselves under control and stick to the facts. Now, can you give me the description of him?
Well, as I remember, he was about my height, maybe 10 or 15 pounds heavier.
No, George, you're wrong. He was at least an inch taller than you.
I say he was about my height, Adam. Wasn't I standing right there in front of him, wasn't I?
Yes, and you were on them floorboards behind the counter, and they're all of an inch thick, so that proves my point.
All right, boys, all right. Suppose you wait till you get home for the rest of the argument. We'll say height approximately 5'7". Can you tell me anything more about him? Color of his hair, clothes he wore?
Well, I'd say his hair was so dark, almost black, and he had a regular...
No, that's wrong. His hair
now,
was
Adam,
brown.
Now, Adam, I look at him.
Merchants in the city to watch the checks on Mutual Bank of Chicago and report. report anyone attempting to cash one at once. Description as follows. Height approximately 5 feet 7 inches.
Hello, operator. Give me the police department. All right.
Alhambra Police Department. Yes, Sergeant speaking.
Hello, Sergeant. This is the Fifth Prime Haberdashery. There's a fellow in here just bought some clothes and wants to cash a $50 cashier's check on Mutual Bank of Chicago. I'll try to stall him until you can get someone over here, but make it fast.
I'll see him there, and I'll have a couple of the boys over in no time.
Okay, but hurry, will you? I don't like the looks of this bird. He's trying to get tough.
Don't worry. Just stall him along.
Okay. Goodbye. If you just have a seat, Mr. Bell, I'll have the money over for you in a minute. We've been keeping very little cash on hand here the last few weeks. There's been a couple of robberies in this district. I just phoned, and the manager will be right over with the money.
I haven't got much time. It won't take him too long to get here.
Well, I'm sure it won't. He said it would only be a matter of a couple of minutes. Could I show you something in shirts or socks while we're waiting? We have some of the very latest patterns in shirting. Now, here's one with a pinstripe. It's becoming very fashionable this season.
I don't want any shirts.
Some handkerchiefs, perhaps. I have a wonderful buy in linen handkerchiefs that my dentist gives. Here, just feel the quality of this linen. It's the very best Irish linen to be found anywhere in this country.
Yeah, nice, all right. I'm going to buy a few of these someday. How much are they?
75 cents. And that's the fairest price I've ever heard of for real Irish linen.
Who called?
This is the man, officer.
Right, get your hands up over your head and don't be wasting any time about it.
Hey, what's the idea? What's going on here?
I think you know well enough. Stick out your wrist.
I stood my well enough. I haven't done anything.
Well, maybe this will make you change your mind. A little bit of jiu-jitsu, an old Japanese friend of mine got me. Now, you're coming along peaceful like, young fella? Am I going to have to drag you?
If you don't have to get rough, I'll go.
That's a smart lad. That way, there's no chance of anybody getting bruised up a bit. Come on. Start away with the car.
Thus, the first chapter of Bad Check Passer Edward Bell comes to a sudden close. Sentenced to 1 to 5 years in the county jail, he spends less than a month in custody. He's then released on probation. 3 weeks later, he's arrested by the Los Angeles police on forgery charges. Spends 2 weeks in jail. Is dismissed because of lack of evidence. In December 1924, the name Edward Bell again appears on the police blotter in Los Angeles on suspicion of robbery charges. But once again, the law finds itself unable to gather sufficient evidence for a conviction, and forger Robert Bell walks out of the city jail a free man. December 31st, 1925. Sergeant Coons of Central ushers a man into the office marked Los Angeles Robbery.
Morning, Captain. I'm brought to that fellow we picked up last night on suspicion of robbery.
Yes, thank you, Sergeant. Well, you again, eh, Sal?
Yeah.
You know, Sergeant, there's something mighty funny about this fellow. He's been in here 3 times now, and within a week or two, he's always been back on the outside.
I proved every time I had nothing to do with the rap you were trying to hang on me.
Yes, you proved it, Sal. But I know just as well as you do that you're as guilty as the devil.
Why don't you tell your boys to lay off me, Kemp? It's a tough on a guy trying to get a decent job, and every time he walks into a joint, an armful of bulls muscle in through the door and drag him off. You know how it is.
I know how it is, all right. Now you listen, Sal. You're heading into a whole lot of trouble for yourself one of these days. I know we can't hold you on this charge. Maybe you'll be in 2 or 3 more times and walk out again. But one of these days, you're going to find yourself right smack in the center of plenty of grief.
Yeah, you think you both are pretty wise guys. You have an idea that someday you're going to frame me and make it stick. Well, there isn't a cop on your force smart enough to get me for keeps. How about telling this yes man of yours to let me out of here?
Okay, Phil. I'll remember that little speech of yours. Sergeant, show this gentleman.
So, egoist Edward Bell once again walked out of the shadow of jail, mingled with the crowd, puzzled inwardly at the stupidity of the law, and the law.
103rd precinct. Death Sergeant speaking.
Notify all patrolmen of deck activities of one Edward Bell. Record 41531. Notify this office of any suspicious movement.
That all of it?
That's all. Look, I
under robbery detail.
Adams, 36 Precinct. Got a report on post 39675 concerning movement to one Edward Bell. Company of one Ward
Telder.
I checked on Telder. He has no record, but he's been mixed up in one or two JD deals.
Good. Keep a couple of the boys on him and report anything else
you
discover.
Okay.
Well, suppose something goes wrong. What happens then?
Nothing can go wrong. I tell you, these both over in Pasadena haven't got brains enough to catch cold. Finally, they've given wise to the fact that we've busted in their tin bank. We'll be clear out of it on our way. I tell you, Ward, I've got what it takes. They haven't made a rap stick on me yet, have they?
No, but there's always a first time.
Two minutes of drink. Hey, George. Come here, will you?
How about these boys in here? Are they all right?
They better be. Well, what I know about them, they wouldn't dare open up their mouths to the law. One little phone call, and out come the four eyes. Find this little street easy, and wham, over they go.
Well, I guess you do know your way around, all right, Eddie.
Sure. Stick around, and you'll go places. Hey, George, how about it?
Okay, boys. What did he this time?
Make it another fist, I mean.
All right, George, and make it better than that last one, will you? A little soup in it.
Always the same crack, eh? More gin, more soup. Okay, boys, I'll make this one right.
That's a spirit. Make it powerful.
Powerful. That's the order. Powerful. Make it a 10-person
sidecar. You sure you're not hitting those sidecars too heavy, Eddie?
Listen to me, Mitten. I'm too heavy. Ward, my boy, I've yet to see the day when liquor began to think for me. My mind's as clear as it ever was.
Well, okay. I was only thinking that you might talk too much if you got a little oil. Forget it.
Okay, it's forgotten. Now, here's the idea. Think it over and sleep on it tonight. In the morning, you'll see how good it is. The bank over in Pasadena that's got plenty of dough laying around waiting for a couple of smart guys like us to pick it up.
What, in the vault?
They call it a vault. Looks to me like a tin can. You can cut through it and nothing flat. Scoop up a few grand and drip. It's a pipe.
Yeah. Where are you going to get the equipment?
That's all fixed, too. I know a guy that works in a welding shop. I talked him into renting me a torch and cutting nozzle. He thinks I'm working on a car in my own garage. We'll pick up the 7 evening and take it over to the house and put it in the garage. Then later we can pick it up and head to the bank. There's nothing to it.
Hey, now, boys. These ought to fix you up fine. They're what I like to call my super, super drink.
I'll tell you what I think of them if that tasted nice.
Go ahead and see what you think.
Well, that tasted better. There's more to it than that last apology for a drink you brought me.
Well, all was on the beef, eh? Well, I'm losing money on this here drink, I'll tell you that much.
Jesus, 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 man.
Well, I got you boys all out here.
Super down, will you? Hard to see any chance of serving any more liquor to that gang. I've passed it now.
Yeah.
Well, let's get back to business. What do you say?
Well, are you sure about this guy with the torch?
Sure. I'm going to see him tonight. Just to sort of screw the trap with him for a while about the car and the, you know. The one I need the torch for.
Yeah, pretty smooth.
It's as smooth as knocking that bank over, will be. How about it?
Well, I'll tell you what, Eddie. Suppose you go see this guy tonight, and I'll meet you here tomorrow and tell you.
Okay, Ward. I'm not the one to rush things. I'll see you here at 1:30 tomorrow. And here's to us.
Yeah, here's to us. Decided it's a go, Eddie.
That's the way to talk. I knew you would. Now, we got to make a little change in our plan.
Hmm? What's the matter? Something go wrong?
No, don't look so worried. Man, I got to thinking last night about this cutting stuff. I figured maybe it'd be a better idea if we didn't try that angle.
Well, I thought you were all set on it.
Sure I was. The candidate got the torch, began to get a little inquisitive last night, wanted to come over and help me with my car and all that. Put me in a spot, so I figure we just better skip him.
Yeah, well, what do we do then?
We'll stick up the bank. Set it that way anyway. Walk in early in the morning just as the bank opens and slip the cashier a note.
I don't like that idea so much.
Listen, Ward, nothing can happen if we work fast. You can wait out in the car and I'll handle the whole stick up myself. All you have to do is be there with the car when I come out and then drive like the devil.
Well, all right. I guess if you think it's okay, it's all right with me. I'll still go.
Good. And go for a drink.
Good.
Hey, George.
Yeah, Hood.
Make it two more, and don't forget the scoop.
Three more coming up.
How about figuring out our move, huh?
Sure. When we get away from the bank, we'll head out Colorado to Orange Grove. Then.
It is the morning of August 17th, 3 days later. Officer Ralph Elstad of the Pasadena Police Force, off duty, is just entering the Gardner Auto Works on the corner of Colorado and Vernon to pick up his car when... Well, what in the devil?
All right, what is that?
Okay.
Hello, Ralph. What's all the noise about out there?
I don't know, Bill. Mind if I use your phone a minute?
No, go right ahead. Gonna call the station?
Yeah. Probably nothing important, but you know me, just a bundle of curiosity.
Operator?
Give me the police station.
Uh-huh, sir.
I was just bringing the car in for that tune-up you promised me, Bill. You got time, Oh, hello?
Pasadena Police. Death Sergeant speaking.
Oh, hello, this is Fred. What's going on?
Larry, you got a car?
Yeah, but what's the...
A couple of guys just held up the National Bank on Fair Oaks and Vernon. Get out to Columbia and Orange Grove Avenue as fast as you can and watch for them. There's a
star touring
car, and at least one of them is
gone. Okay, Sergeant.
Well, what's the dope?
I'm sorry, Bill. I can't stay to tell you now. I'm in a big hurry.
Harrison and Walker are covering the Colorado Street Bridge. Jack proceeds to Columbia and Orange Grove right away.
Going like the devil?
No, I haven't, mister.
How long you been here?
Oh, a couple of hours.
Good. That means I haven't gotten out of town this way. I wouldn't be a bit surprised, Daddy. Get out of line. There may be shooting.
Short minutes after Fell and Pelter made their daring raid on the bank, The long arm of the law reached out. Will fell, that the handcuffs on Felder. Officer Fred Walker's wounds were not as serious as at first feared. Motorcycle Officer Ed Ewing suffered no more than superficial cuts and abrasions as a result of his fall. Officer Sheriff Page, in facing an armed bandit, when he was reasonably sure that his gun was empty, stands as an eloquent tribute to the men that make up the fashion of police department. There is instances like this that in the final analysis prove conclusively that the lawbreaker has very little chance with such men on his heels.
Thank you, Chief Tucker. The exciting chase and capture of escaping criminals is only part of the work of police cars. Every hour of the day and night, thousands of police cars cruise through the streets of our city using the same roads that you use, making the same stops, climbing the same hills. What an ideal test for gasoline. The selection of Rio Grande cracked gasoline to power more police and emergency cars than any other brand is proof that you can get more economical operation from cracked gasoline as well as greater power and speed. It costs no more to use the same Rio Grande cracked gasoline your police cars use.
Gasoline the police calling all cars, attention all cars, cancellation broadcast 104. Suspectionist case are now in custody. That's all.
Calling All Cars is written and produced by William N. Robson. This is your narrator, Frederick Lindsley, bidding you good night for the Rio Grande Oil Company.